All right, this is the seventh lesson I'm doing on the book of Ephesians. We're just going verse by verse through, doing an overview of Ephesians. We got through verse 19 last time, so actually this should read, we're going to start here at Ephesians 3 and verse 20. We have two verses left in Paul's prayer in chapter 3, then we'll be in chapter 4. We've already gone through the main part of the prayer. He said there in Ephesians 3:14, "For this cause I bow my knees unto the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, of whom the whole family in heaven and earth is named," because Ephesians 1:10, "in the dispensation of the fullness of times, God's gathering together all things in Christ, both in heaven and in earth." Verse 16, "that he would grant you according to the riches of his glory," Father of glory, Ephesians 1:17, "to be strengthened with might by his spirit in the inner man." So he's praying not for you to get your toe healed or your stomach healed or your back healed, but he's praying for you spiritually speaking, that you would read God's word, believe what it says, get sound doctrine in the inner man, and then you're strengthened with might by his spirit in the inner man so that you can overcome Satan's attacks and share God's love to others. It's a spiritual war we're in. We walk by faith and not by sight. Verse 17, "that Christ may dwell in your hearts by faith." Faith cometh by hearing, hearing by the word of God. So if I've got sound doctrine in the inner man, then Christ is dwelling in my heart by faith. "Faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen," Hebrews 11:1 says. So faith is not, it's not a feeling. It's like, well, I don't know. I don't know what it means. I'll just accept it in faith that it's true. Now, faith is substance. And it's evidence of the spiritual realm, the things that we can't see. And faith comes by God's word, not by feelings or, I don't understand, so I'll take it in faith. No, it's the exact opposite. It's when you understand the spiritual things, then you have substance and evidence of the spiritual realm. "That ye being rooted and grounded in love." So you got to have sound doctrine in the inner man. You use that in your life using the mind of Christ. As a result, you go through trials, and then those trials build up God's love in you. Romans 5:2-5. Verse 18, "may be able to comprehend with all saints what is the breadth and length and depth and height." So now we're talking about all the spiritual realm, that you would understand all the details of things that, of how things run in heavenly places. The currency in heaven is love. So if you got sound doctrine in the inner man, you use that mind of Christ to live it out, and then you are rooted and grounded in love, and love is the currency of heaven. So then you understand the breadth and the length and the depth and the height of spiritual places. You understand how that's going to be played out in eternity. Verse 19, "and to know the love of Christ, which passeth knowledge." Not that it replaces knowledge. People think of love as a feeling or an emotion, but it's really based upon sound doctrine that you've used, and then you suffer for it, and then love is built out of that. In a marriage situation, really where the love is built between the husband and wife, where they love one another more later on than they did at first, is because they've gone through life. I mean, things in life, you suffer in life, you know, and you work it out, and you go together, and so that love is built up. Well, it's the same thing with our relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. We are one with Christ. You are dead. Your life is hid with Christ in God. Christ is in you. And so when you use the love of Christ coming through you as a result of applying sound doctrine in the inner man, then that love of Christ passes knowledge or builds on that knowledge, that ye might be filled with all the fullness of God. And then there's a period there. So now verse 20. So that was a review of what we covered last time. So now, new territory here, verses 20 and 21 of Ephesians 3, he's going to conclude the prayer. Verse 20, "now unto him that is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that worketh in us." Well, exceeding abundantly above all that we ask or think, the reason is because what he's doing it in heavenly places. You know, Ephesians 1:3 says we're blessed with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ. Ephesians 2:7 says in the ages to come that God is going to show forth the exceeding riches of his grace and his kindness towards us through Christ Jesus. Ephesians 2:6 says we are raised up together and God's made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. Verse 10, Ephesians 2:10 says we are His workmanship created in Christ Jesus unto good works, which God hath before ordained that we should walk in them. So you see, the whole focus is in heavenly places. And it is when I've got sound doctrine in the inner man and I suffer for it in this world, since Satan is the god of this world, 2 Corinthians 4:4, he has the world operating by his course, Ephesians 2:2. Then when I go against the course and against the god of this world, then I suffer, 2 Timothy 3:12. Yea, all that will live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution. So when I suffer the persecution for godly living, Romans 5:2-5 says, I'll have tribulation, which works patience, which works experience, which works hope, and then hope maketh not ashamed, because the love of God is shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Ghost, which is given unto us. So now I've got more of God's love coming through me. Romans 5:8 says that God commendeth his love toward us, and that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. That's how his love was commended toward us. But we didn't actually give out that love to others, so we received his love when we trusted in Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection as atonement for our sin. But we didn't actually give out that love until we live by the doctrine, have the love of Christ applied as we suffer for it. And so then we have more of God's love built up. So then when God's love is shared through us in heaven for all eternity and on the earth as well, then it brings glory to God. God gets glory by people being saved and coming into the knowledge of the truth. So when we live by that sound doctrine, John 13, verse 35 says, by this shall all men know that ye are my disciples, if ye have love one to another. That's John 13:35. So if someone is looking for the truth, God is a rewarder of those who diligently seek Him. So when someone diligently seeks God, they recognize their sin, then God will reward them with the saving gospel. But how do you know, if I preach a gospel that's different from the person down the road, and then the church over across the street preaches a different gospel, well, how do you know which one you're going to listen to? A big part of it is men know Jesus in you by love. If you've got God's love coming through you to others, then they'll say, well, that is the saving gospel, because that's what's different about this, about Christians as opposed to everybody else. Because and only Bible believers who are letting Christ live in them are showing God's unconditional love to others. Now, there may be a lot of times when people show love, it's the love of this world, the husband and wife. If you're both unbelievers, you don't have true unconditional love. You may stay with the person the rest of your life, but there are other factors involved as to why you do that. If someone just completely mistreats you and hates you and does all these things against you, chances are you won't have anything to do with them. If you do stay with them, there are other reasons for it. But only when you have God's love coming through you as a result of sound doctrine coming through you, then that is true unconditional love. So when people do nice things for others, they're always like, okay, what's the catch here? Nothing's free. No such thing as a free lunch. So what are you doing here? You must have an ulterior motive. You must be getting something out of it. Somewhere, somehow down the line, you're getting something, or else you wouldn't be doing it for me. The only case where that's, the only instance where that's not the case is when God's love comes through a Bible believer to others. And that's how you know God's love versus man's love. I mean, look at the Antichrist when Jesus, during the tribulation period. The Antichrist, 2 Thessalonians 2 says, he's going to be doing lion signs and wonders. Well, the little flock, believing remnant of Israel, they also are going to be doing signs and wonders. The signs and the wonders, according to Mark 16:20, confirm that the gospel that they preach is the correct gospel. But The Antichrist people, they're doing signs and wonders too. So how do I know if you're a member of the lost sheep of the house of Israel and you're looking for the gospel that will save them, that will give them eternal life? Do you trust in the Antichrist or do you trust in the gospel that the little flock has given? Well, that's where John 13:35 comes in. Both groups, the Antichrist groups and the little flocks group, they're both doing signs and wonders. But by this shall all men know that ye are my disciples, if ye have love one for another. So men are going to know that the lost sheep of the house of Israel, when they're looking for the answer, they'll know to listen to the little flock's gospel of the kingdom rather than the gospel of the Antichrist people, because they will see God's love coming through the little flock to others. It is an unconditional love. The Antichrist people may act nice, but then all of a sudden you see they're killing people. Why are you killing people who won't bow down to the image or take the mark? God doesn't kill people if you don't do a certain commandment. So they'll see, I see God's love coming through the little flock. Therefore, I know their gospel is true. And so it's the same thing for us, is that when God's love, you see in Ephesians 3, and we talked about this last time, we saw in verse 16, you're strengthened with might by His Spirit in the inner man. So that is, so Ephesians 3:16 is sound doctrine. Then, when you're strengthened with might, then verse 17 says that you're going to be rooted and grounded in love. Then verse 18 says you're able to comprehend with all saints what is the breadth and length and depth and height. So verse 18, you go back to knowledge. And then verse 19, to know the love of Christ, which passeth knowledge. So when you get sound doctrine in the inner man, you use it, you apply it, you go through trials, God's love comes through you. Then you get more sound doctrine, you get more knowledge, and you get more of God's love coming through you. And so that's what verse 20 is talking about. The world, when it says, now unto him that is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we ask or think. We're not talking about, if I ask God to give me to win $1 million in the lotto, since He can do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or think, and I'm asking for $1 million prize, He'll give me $100 million lotto prize, right? Or if I ask God to heal my back that's bad, well, not only will He heal my back, but now I can do somersaults and all kinds of things with my back that I couldn't do before I had the back injury. Now, we're not talking about the physical realm. This is all about the spiritual realm. Sound doctrine works love, which works, you get more knowledge and you get more love. So more knowledge, more love. You get more love in the inner man than in heavenly places. You can have a higher position there and you can bring greater glory to God. And of course, on the earth as well, I'm already saved, I can get sound doctrine in the inner man, and then as a result of the love and the knowledge combined, then when other people see Christ in me, then they can also be saved when I share the gospel, or they'll also get into the knowledge of the truth when I give them sound doctrine, because they see God's love coming through me. So they'll believe me over the next person, because they don't see an ulterior motive with me. They see genuine, unconditional agape love of the Lord Jesus Christ coming through me. And so the exceeding abundantly above all that we ask or think today is, of course, God's will. So people being, so we're talking about people being saved, salvation, and knowledge of the truth for them. And for you as well. I mean, your thought process has changed. Your addictions to sinful behaviors can be replaced by the sound doctrine. The things that you are spiritually, your attitude, depression, anxiety, different things of the flesh. People have all kinds of problems. They're taking all kinds of drugs, going to psychiatrists. So many people stressed out over work and just things in life stressing them out. Events that happen, then you can just have Christ living in you. And you can be just that solid, steady person who, regardless of what happens, no matter if it's bad or not, then Christ lives through you. Well, that helps, because then they see God's love coming through you. That helps people to be saved and come into the knowledge of the truth. But it also helps you spiritually as well. You're not an emotional wreck. You don't have to be on all kinds of mental health medication and psychiatrists and all that stuff. You just have God's word. I know for me, when I was before I got married, you know, I get kind of lonely by myself. Well, I'd go read Ephesians 1. And when I see in verse 3, I'm blessed with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places. That at verse 4, I'm holy and without blame before Him in love. That verse 5, I'm predestinated and adopted as His child. Verse 6, I'm accepted in the Beloved. Verse 7, I have redemption and the forgiveness of sins. Verse 8, I've got all wisdom and prudence in God's word here. Verse 9, I've got the mystery of His will revealed to me. Verse 10, I'm gathered together in Christ. Verse 11, I've got an inheritance. Verse 13 and 14, I'm sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise until actually I'm raptured up. You know, and you just keep reading through here. And raised from the dead there in verse 19, according to the power of God, which He wrought in Christ when He raised Him from the dead. And I'm part of the body of Christ in heavenly places. I got a position there, verses 21 through 23. Now all of a sudden, being single, not having a wife, doesn't seem like a big deal anymore. And in fact, in 1 Corinthians 7, when Paul talks about, you know, the people are married, he said, well, you know, if you're married, it's like you're really single. And if you're single, it's like you're really married. And what he's saying is, 50 years, what, you have a relationship for 50 years, maybe you're married, or 50 years you're single, compared to millions and billions and trillions of years in eternity, it's nothing. So what if circumstances are favorable toward you in this life? Or so what if they're unfavorable? Either you're happy for 50 years or you're suffering for 50 years, but either way, that goes away, because in eternity, you're rejoicing evermore. You've got the joy of the Lord through you. So what's the big deal, right? It completely changes your focus when you recognize who you are in Christ. So you get depressed. Go read Ephesians 1. That's what I tell people. They probably don't like that answer. And they say, well, it didn't work. Well, read it again. Don't just read it to be reading it to say you read it. Read it and actually listen to what it says and believe what it says. And how could you be depressed after all those things we've already mentioned? So, and so that verse 20 now, Ephesians 3:20, that's what it's talking about. It's when He's able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we ask or think. It's spiritually speaking. You know, God's not going, if I pray for $1 million in the lotto, He's not going to give me $100 million. If I pray that I can run a 5K, doesn't mean I'm going to run a marathon. If I pray for God to heal my physical ailment, doesn't mean it's going to be healed and better than new. It is just talking about spiritually speaking. And of course, this is a lot harder, what He's doing here. God's love coming through me? I don't see that happening in the world, no matter how hard they try, because in their flesh dwells no good thing. So Him doing exceeding abundantly above all that we ask or think is talking about spiritually, and you can see it at the end of the verse. It says, now unto Him that is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that worketh in us. So the way that He does abundantly above all that we ask or think is according to the power that worketh in us. And we learn what that power is over in Ephesians chapter 1. Ephesians chapter 1 and verse 18, he says, the eyes of your understanding being enlightened, that ye may know what is the hope of His calling, and what the riches of the glory of His inheritance in the saints, and what is the exceeding greatness of His power. Notice we saw in Ephesians 3:20, exceeding abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that worketh in us. Here you've got Ephesians 1:19, the exceeding greatness of His power to usward who believe, according to the working of His mighty power. So before, in Ephesians 3:20, it's the power that worketh in us. What's the power that worketh in us? Ephesians 1:19, It's the working of his mighty power. That power is to usward who believe. And that mighty power, verse 20, Ephesians 1:20, mighty, according to the working of his mighty power, Ephesians 1:20, which he wrought in Christ when he raised him from the dead and set him at his own right hand in the heavenly places, far above all principality and power, might and dominion, and every name that is named, not only in this world, but also in that which is to come, and hath put all things under his feet, and gave him to be the head over all things to the church, which is his body, the fullness of him that filleth all in all. The body of Christ is going to fill all positions in heavenly places, the thrones, principalities, powers, mights, dominions, every name that is named. So, and that shows you then that the mighty power of God, which he wrought in Christ when he raised him from the dead, is also working in you. And the reason we know that is because of, Romans 6 tells us. Romans 6 tells us that once we believe the gospel, Romans 6:4 says, therefore we are buried with him by baptism into death, that like as Christ was raised up from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also should walk in newness of life. For if we have been planted together in the likeness of his death, we shall be also in the likeness of his resurrection, knowing this, that our old man is crucified with him, that the body of sin might be destroyed, that henceforth we should not serve sin. And since we don't serve sin, then verse 10 says, and that he died unto sin once, but then that he liveth unto God. Likewise reckon ye also yourselves to be dead indeed unto sin, but alive unto God through Jesus Christ our Lord. You see, the mighty power of God, and what's so great about it, is you think of who we were. None good, no, not one. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. So, wages of sin is death. So, the result of who you were dead in sins. That was Ephesians 2:1. And bound for hell, where you would suffer forever in a lake of fire. You would be punished for your sins, and since you can never make the full payment for your sins, you would suffer eternally there. Because you're always trying to pay the sin debt, and you never satisfy it, so you keep paying. You know, it's sort of like the credit card with the 20% interest is, well, the minimum payment is $10, but the debt you owe is $5,000. If all you do is make the minimum payment, you'll never pay it off, because the interest that accrues on the debt is greater than the amount that you're paying every month. So you're making the minimum payment so they don't repossess the stuff that you bought, but the outstanding balance, the principal, keeps getting more and more. And that's how it is in hell. You've sinned. Wages of sin is death. So you got to pay for your sins. But you have so much sin debt and so little resources to pay that you will never pay it off. So you suffer eternally in hell. And the idea in churchianity is that, oh, I just hope I can endure unto the end as long as I am faithful. I just want to hear God say, well done, thou good and faithful servant. And it's like, it's a struggle. You spend your whole life trying to make sure that you make it toward the end. But what we've learned is that when you trusted in Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection as atonement for your sin, you see, Christ, what he did, 2 Corinthians 5:20 says, 2 Corinthians 5:21, 2 Corinthians 5:21 says, for he, God, hath made him, Christ, to be sin for us. God hath made Christ to be sin for us who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. So if my situation is that I've got so much sin and I don't have the ability to pay it, therefore I'd always be trying to pay that debt and I couldn't do it. So then my sin is placed upon Christ. Now, the debt is still enormous, but the difference is Christ, because he has life, he's able to overcome the death. So Isaiah 53 says that his soul is made an offering for sin, and then God would see of the travail of his soul and shall be satisfied. That's Isaiah 53, verse 10, and then verse 11. Isaiah 53, 11, God shall see of the travail of Jesus' soul and shall be satisfied. So he's going to travail there. and the justice of God is satisfied. Then you've got God coming and saving him from hell. And it wasn't an easy thing. Sure, he made the payment for death, but he had to, you know, God, he had great power in coming and saving him. I think it's at the end of 2 Samuel where we read about that. It's really tremendous to read this. 2 Samuel 22, and you also see it in Psalm 18. It says, 2 Samuel 22:7, that referring to Jesus, verse 5, 2 Samuel 22:5, when the waves of death compassed me, the floods of ungodly men made me afraid. The sorrows of hell compassed me about. The snares of death prevented me. In my distress, I called upon the Lord and cried to my God. And he did hear my voice out of his temple, and my cry did enter into his ears. Okay, so Isaiah 53. He's seen the travail of his soul, and it is satisfied. The justice of God is satisfied. Christ has made the full payment for our sin. So what is, as Ephesians 1 says in verse 19, the working of his mighty power, which he wrought in Christ when he raised him from the dead. He worked it. He wrought it. He created it in Christ when he raised him from the dead. How did he do it? 2 Samuel 22, verse 8. Then the earth shook and trembled. The foundations of heaven moved and shook because he was wroth. There went up a smoke out of his nostrils and fire out of his mouth. Devoured coals were kindled by it. He bowed the heavens also and came down, and darkness was under his feet. He rode upon a cherub and did fly. He was seen upon the wings of the wind. He made darkness pavilions round about him, dark waters and thick clouds of the skies. Through the brightness before him were coals of the fire kindled. The Lord thundered from heaven, and the Most High uttered his voice. He sent out arrows and scattered them, lightning and discomfited them. The channels of the sea appeared. The foundations of the world were discovered at the rebuking of the Lord. At the blast of the breath of his nostrils, he sent from above. He took me. He drew me out of many waters. He delivered me from my strong enemy and from them that hated me, for they were too strong for me. They prevented me in the day of my calamity, but the Lord was my stay. He brought me forth also into a large place. He delivered me because he delighted in me. The Lord rewarded me according to my righteousness, according to the cleanness of my hands hath he recompensed me. So that was 2 Samuel 22, 8 through 21. 2 Samuel 22, 8 through 21. You need to write that reference, and I'm going to do it right now in my Bible. I'm telling you to do it. I'm going to do it too. You need to write that reference down when it says in Ephesians 1:19, according to the working of his mighty power, which he brought in Christ when he raised him from the dead. That description of that is 2 Samuel 22, 8 through 21. That's the power. Why do you think, why does churchianity think that if they obey the Ten Commandments, if they confess their sins and keep short accounts with God, if they do what Jesus said to do in the red letters, why do they think that they'll just squeak into heaven? You notice this was our sin isn't just something where God says, karma, you know, if it out more good things than bad things, oh, you tip the scale and you get to go to heaven. Or you make sure you read the Bible every day and you confess your sins, okay, then you get to go to heaven. Yeah, your sin was just so bad it separated you from God. The weight of the sin is enormous. That I would have to spend eternity. I'm dead in sins. I'd spend eternity in hell trying to pay for those sins, and I can never pay for them. So in Christ, when my sin was placed upon him, and he cried for help, the power of God, it takes 14 verses. 2 Samuel 22, 8 through 21. It takes 14 verses to describe the mighty power which God wrought in Christ when he raised him from the dead. And according to Ephesians 1:19, the greatness, exceeding greatness of his power is to usward who believe. The power of God isn't just to save you from hell. But you notice also at the end of that, it says, the Lord delivered me and put me in a large place, and he rewarded me according to my righteousness. What's the reward? Ephesians 1:20, that he set him at his own right hand in the heavenly places, far above all principality and power and might and dominion and every name that is named. So when you look in Ephesians 3:20, now to him that is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that worketh in us. Don't think of it as, well, I was a bad person, and then Christ died for my sins, and then I showed that I had true saving faith because I went to church every time the doors were open for the rest of my life. I read my Bible whenever I could. Whenever I did what I shouldn't have done, I asked God to forgive me. And so then in the end, I just squeaked into heaven by the skin of my teeth, and now I get to sit on a cloud and play a harp. That's not what happened. What happened was that all your sins, past, present, and future, were placed upon Christ when he died on that cross. And then he went down to hell and he suffered. His soul travailed. He was in anguish. And then he made the full payment for sin, and God says, the justice, my justice has been satisfied. Now, Jesus says, okay, well, get me out of this place. And you got 14 verses of the exceeding greatness of his power, which he wrought in Christ when he raised him from the dead. And he didn't just raise him from the dead, said, okay, sit on a cloud and play a harp. You did your work. Now rest. He says, now you are far above all principality, power, might, and dominion in every name that is named. You think of today, the president of the United States. He's far above all powers on the earth. Maybe not far above, but far above, or he's above the highest office in the United States, at least that. So he doesn't just sit around vacation. He's got a tremendous responsibility. He's got to make all kinds of decisions. Well, the reason, at least the reason you should put the person in the presidential spot, is because that's somebody who can handle it. Currently, we don't have somebody like that, but that's what you should do. Well, God, he is just, he is right. So he says, I finally got somebody who can handle the handling, running heavenly places. And that's the Lord Jesus Christ, because he's made the full payment for sin. And he was a man tempted as we are in every point, yet without sin. So he's the perfect one to be above everything. He will make the perfect decisions, because he'll always do it based upon my word, God says, but also have my love and compassion and grace and mercy. And so he's the perfect one. So he places him in that position. And then that same power is given to us who believe. And then Christ says, okay, I know, you know, I understand what you tempted and how you sin. I understand all that. So now, based upon how much sound doctrine you have in the inner man and how much love that's built up, which gives you more sound doctrine, knowledge, which builds more love, the more you got of that, the higher the position you'll have. And so the exceeding abundantly above all that we ask and think, or think, is according to the power that worketh in us. We're talking about positions in heavenly places. It's not that you just squeak into heaven by the skin of your teeth, but it's that Christ says, okay, I've got thrones, principalities, powers, and mights, and dominions. And if you've got sound doctrine in the inner man, and my love comes through you, and you get more sound doctrine, and you get more of God's love, now I could place you in a higher position in heavenly places and give you great responsibility. And you will do it perfectly because Christ will live in you. You will live by the faith of the Son of God according to the sound doctrine in your inner man. And so it's not that God just saved you from hell, which is a glorious thing. I don't want to diminish that. I mean, it's great that you don't have to suffer forever in hell. But now he's bringing you to a position of great authority, giving you clothing glory, clothing of light, and God's love coming through you brings great glory to God, which is why Ephesians 1:17 says that this plan is God the Father came up with the Father. He's the Father of glory. It's the glory plan. So it's not just you're dead in sins, you're bound for hell, and now you've got salvation. But really, when he's doing exceeding abundantly above all that we ask and think, that is bringing great glory. Bringing great glory to God eternally in heavenly places. That's the exceeding abundantly above all that we ask or think. See, we think of it in physical terms. Oh, I'll ask God for $1 million in the lottery. Maybe he'll give me 10. 10 million. Who cares? So you got $10 million. What are you going to do with it? Well, I'll do a lot of good things on the earth. I'll buy my parents a house. I'll buy my kids a house. I'll, you know, help help the community out, I'll do all these. And maybe you do all those things. But when you die, and when those people die, they got nothing. Yeah, it helped them out temporarily. But if God is bringing His love through you, when you go to heaven, He'll continue to do that. And it'll only get better and better, and it'll be more glorious. If God's love is coming through you now, in a world where Satan is the god of this world, where the world is following his course, where the world is under his curse, well, the curse of sin, I should say, just think of how glorious things will be in heavenly places when all of that is removed. And so this is far greater than we can't even imagine. I mean, I'm trying to describe what he's doing here, bringing great glory to God eternally. It's so great, we can't even fathom how great it is. So he's able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we ask or think. Not just a little bit above, but exceeding abundantly. That's a whole lot more. Because we can't even ask or think of the great glory that God is going to get for all eternity through us as a result of the sound doctrine in the inner man and the love of Christ coming through us. We can't even fathom that. He's above all that we ask or think. And that's according to the power that worketh in us. And then verse 21, unto him be glory in the church by Christ Jesus throughout all ages, world without end. Amen. So verse 21 is summing up what we just talked about. He says, unto him be glory. Where is the glory? The glory is in the church. So that's us. That's not the Catholic Church, the Baptist Church, a building. The church is the people. Ephesians 1 says, Ephesians 1:22, that God hath put all things under Christ's feet and gave him to be the head over all things to the church, which is his body. So the church, by definition, the church is the body of Christ. Body of Christ. So, Ephesians 3:21, unto him be glory in the church. So, glory in the body of Christ. How? By Christ Jesus. Because what we're going to be doing is Galatians 2:20. I am crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live, yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. Now today, if I decide to present my body a living sacrifice, if I decide to live by sound doctrine, if I decide to walk in the Spirit, then I'm living by the faith of the Son of God and bringing great glory to God. If I decide to do those things. In heavenly, but I may decide to operate by my vile flesh. And I may be doing just as much as, you know, the heathen are doing. But in heavenly places, my vile flesh is going to be replaced by his glorious body in the Philippians 3:21 at the rapture of the church. So then, and the reason you got to wait for the rapture is because then that's when the whole body is there. You can think of sort of the time from your death to the time of the rapture as like a gestation period in the womb. When God is making you in the womb, it takes 9 months. And maybe, let's say, the arm is ready, but the legs aren't ready yet. Or maybe all that's ready, but the internal organs aren't ready yet. So it takes, you can't just get out of the, if you get out of the womb before the whole body is done, well, you got trouble. That's why babies that are born prematurely, you know, the rate of survival is slim. Or, you know, especially they'll be real skinny. Maybe they'll have, even if they survive, they'll have health problems, health issues, because they weren't fully formed in the womb yet. You got to wait for the whole 9 months before the baby is ready. So the rapture of the church, you can think of the grave as that gestation period in the womb. Sure, the arm is ready, but the hand isn't ready, or the leg isn't ready, or the internal organs aren't ready. There's all these, you know, you got to get all the members of the body of Christ, which is his body, the fullness of him that filleth all in all. Until the whole body is ready, then you can't have the body. You know, you can't just have an arm, you know, when the mother's, God doesn't say, okay, I got the arm ready, and then the arm pops out of the mother's womb. Okay, I got the leg ready, leg pops out of the mother's womb. It doesn't work that way. the whole body's got to be ready. Once the whole body's ready, then the whole body pops out of the womb. Well, it doesn't actually pop out of the womb, but you know what I mean. It takes that whole 9 months. So rapture of the church. You can't have your glorified body in heavenly places until the whole body is ready. So then you get that at the rapture. Okay? So, when I get that body in heavenly places, now Galatians 2:20 is going to work all the time. I live by the faith of the Son of God. I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live. Yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God. So in heavenly places, so glory in the church by Christ Jesus, meaning his faith through you. So Christ's faith comes through you in heavenly places. So Ephesians 3:21, unto him be glory in the church, body of Christ, by Christ Jesus, his faith coming through you. That's why you got to get sound doctrine in the inner man. If you don't have the sound doctrine, you don't have the love of Christ. So then when they ask you, and the angels say, well, what do I do in this situation? You say, I don't know. I didn't read that one yet. I don't know that one yet. Well, and Christ can't put you in that position where you would make those decisions. You know, at my work, I got a managerial position, but there are people over me. There are people under me. They're not going to ask me to take those position, you know, those decisions that the superintendent of the schools makes. Those are high-level decisions. I've been there 8 years. I haven't been asked to make a single one of those. And they're not going to ask me because I'm not at that position where I'm qualified. I make a decision, probably wouldn't be the best decision because I don't have all the knowledge in me to make that decision. You don't have much sound doctrine in God's Word. Christ isn't going to trust you with high-level decisions because you don't have the... You're not equipped for it. You don't have the knowledge to be able to make those decisions. So the more sound doctrine you get, the more of God's love is coming through you. So then more glory bring in to God in the church by the body, by Christ Jesus, his faith working through you. Which is why Paul is praying all this and the reason for this prayer. You could call this Ephesians 3:14 through 21. You could call this the glory prayer. He's prayed for God to get great glory. So you see there at the end of the prayer, unto him be glory in the church by Christ Jesus. And it says, throughout all ages. Well, we know from Ephesians 2 and verse 7 that into ages to come he might show the exceeding riches of his grace and his kindness towards us through Christ Jesus. So when age comes about, and there's the exceeding riches of his grace. You bring God glory. And the next age, you bring God even greater glory. Next age, you bring God even greater glory. You can think of your career and life. Usually, you bring greater value. You get a greater salary as time goes on because you bring greater value to an organization because you have greater education and experience so you can handle higher level decisions which make more money for the company. So you can think of that when you're in heavenly places. You'll bring greater glory to God in the fifth age down the road as opposed to the third age. So you'll have a higher position as a result of that because you have more education and experience in the spiritual realm. So so that's why it's going to be throughout all ages. And then it says world without end. World without end tells you that this is for eternity. That's why I said you're bringing great glory to God eternally, because it's world without end. So this is why this is my favorite prayer, and of all of Paul's prayers. You can call Ephesians 3:14 through 21 the glory prayer. The glory prayer. You can bring God great glory through sound doctrine, which results in love, and you get more sound doctrine, and you get more of God's love, and God's love coming through you brings God glory. And in heavenly places, you won't have the vile flesh, so you bring God even greater glory by Christ Jesus, his faith through you, throughout all ages, world without end. All right, so that was Ephesians chapter 3. Now, we get to Ephesians chapter 4. I therefore, so what you've got here now is he's given you some doctrine in the first three chapters. Advanced doctrine, the doctrine of charity or love, which is what we've been talking about with this prayer. He's concluded it, which sort of bringing a summary of all of it together with this prayer in Ephesians 3, 14 through 21. And now he's going to make the application of that starting in chapter 4. So he says, Ephesians 4, 1, I therefore, the prisoner of the Lord. A prisoner of the Lord meaning that he has been called. He is physically in a prison at the time. But if you look over, well, I probably shouldn't erase that. Anyway, we'll start at the top here. We'll start at the top. New chapter, new board. I hope you wrote it all down. I usually erase the top part and leave the bottom. But anyway, we know from 1 Corinthians 9, from 1 Corinthians 9 and verse 16, 1 Corinthians 9, 16, for though I preach the gospel, I have nothing to glory of, for necessity is laid upon me, yea, woe is unto me if I preach not the gospel. Why? Verse 17, for if I do this thing willingly, I have a reward. But if against my will, a dispensation of the gospel is committed unto me. Acts 9:15. The Lord Jesus Christ commissions Paul to go to all the heathen, all unbelievers, Gentiles, kings, Jews, everybody. So he's commissioned with the dispensation of the gospel. So Ephesians 4:1, he says he is a prisoner. Prisoner of what? Of the Lord. Prisoner of the Lord. Meaning 1 Corinthians 9:17, dispense gospel. Dispense mystery gospel. Mystery gospel, we saw at the beginning of Ephesians 3, was given to Paul, and he's responsible for that. So that's why he's considered a prisoner of the Lord. It's not that he's forced to do it, but it is just that's what Christ has commissioned him to do. And he knows, Christ knows he's going to do it and do it well, because it's going to be Christ living in him doing it. And he knows that Paul will dedicate his time to fulfill that mission. If he didn't, then Christ would have picked somebody else. Christ has full knowledge of the future, being God, so then he can decide who to pick for that. So he picked Paul, so we know that Paul will do this. Prisoner of the Lord, 1 Corinthians 6, I think is the verse. 1 Corinthians 6, 19. 1 Corinthians 6:19. What, know ye not that your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost which is in you, which ye have of God, and ye are not your own? For ye are bought with a price. Therefore glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God's. So 1 Corinthians 6:19, we just talked about what Jesus went through to pay for your sin, and what God did, the working of his mighty power which he wrought in Christ when he raised him from the dead. We went over that. So you were bought with a great price, the shed blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. And so it says there, 1 Corinthians 6:20, body and spirit belong to God. So that's how Paul is a prisoner of the Lord. Prisoner, a lot of times we think he's forced to, but no, it's just as an obligation, because that's what he signed up for when he allowed Christ to save him by trusting in Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection as atonement for his sin. And he's got a specific commission dispensing the mystery gospel to all unbelievers. So he's got that to do. But again, it's in love. A lot of times we think prisoner, it's a bad situation, you know. Bread and water is all you get. We're not going to treat you fairly. Well, this is God's love. God loves him. So it's a badge of honor to say he is the prisoner of the Lord. So he says, I therefore, Ephesians 4:1, I therefore, the prisoner of the Lord, beseech you. Beseech. Beseech is a grace word. Beseech means, and you'll see this throughout Paul's epistles, it means to strongly encourage. When you're under the law, this is a grace word. Strongly encourage. This is a grace word. Because when you're under grace, Paul says to the Corinthians, 1 Corinthians 6, 1 Corinthians 11. No, those aren't the ones I was looking for. 1 Corinthians 4 and 1 Corinthians 10. He says in 1 Corinthians 4, I think. No, the one I gave you first was right. 1 Corinthians 6 and 1 Corinthians 11. Yeah, 1 Corinthians 6, 12. 1 Corinthians 6, 12. All things are lawful unto me, but all things are not expedient. And then 1 Corinthians 10, verse 23. All things are lawful for me, but all things are not expedient. So 1 Corinthians 6, let me write them down. 1 Corinthians 6, 12. 1 Corinthians 10, 23. 10, 23. All things are lawful. It shows we're under grace. All our sins are forgiven. We can do whatever we want. And it's not as a license to sin, but it's now that we don't have to worry about sin since it's fully paid by the cross work of Christ. Now we can live in grace and allow, standing in grace, we can have the faith, by whom also we have access by faith, faith of Christ, into this grace wherein we stand and rejoice in hope of the glory of God. Romans 5, 2. If I'm standing under the law, I'm fearful that our God is a consuming fire and that God's going to destroy me if I mess up. But if I've got, so my expectation is to be struck by God, which is why I'm always toeing the line. It's like he's just waiting to zap me when I do something wrong. But under grace, it is, I rejoice in hope of the glory of God. Rejoice in the confident expectation that God's glory is going to come through me as a result of what we talked about there in the first part of this message, you know, Ephesians chapter 3. So I rejoice in hope of the glory of God. So all things are lawful unto me. Not all things are expedient, but now I don't have to worry about sinning. So when you get to Ephesians 4:1, he says, I beseech you. I therefore, the prisoner of the Lord, beseech you. So I'm going to strongly encourage you. Command is a law word. Thou shalt have no other gods before me. Thou shalt not make unto thee any graven image. Thou shalt not take the name of the Lord thy God in vain. Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. Honor thy father and mother. And all the way down the line there. Those are commandments. You've got to do these things. If you don't do it, curses on you. Cursed is everyone who does not continue in all the things of the law to do those things. The blessings are only when you obey the law. The curses is when you disobey. But we're not under the law, we're under grace. Romans 6:14 says, you're not under the law, you're under grace. So all things are lawful unto me, 1 Corinthians 6:12 and 1 Corinthians 10:23. So Paul isn't going to command them, he's going to beseech them. So he says, you see how he beseeched them. And that's why the prisoner of the Lord is brought up and why I went through that. He's the prisoner of the Lord, but don't think of it in terms of how we think of it. It's like, oh, you're going to be mistreated. You don't have anything. You don't have any rights. It's, no, the Lord loves him. And the Lord loved him by giving him a specific commission as the apostle of the Gentiles. Yes, he's bought with a price. Yes, he's the Lord's prisoner. But he has the unique opportunity to dispense the mystery gospel to all unbelievers. I mean, can you imagine the glory that Paul brought the Lord Jesus Christ while on earth? Once after he was saved, think of how much greater glory he's going to bring in ages to come. Throughout all eternity, the great glory that Paul will bring to the Lord Jesus Christ and to God in that time. What a unique opportunity it is. So he says, yes, I'm the prisoner of the Lord. I have to dispense this mystery gospel. But again, God loves me, so all things are lawful to me. He's not going to throw me in hell if I don't do it. But he's saying, as the prisoner of the Lord, I understand. The Lord said to dispense this mystery gospel to all unbelievers. And I've got the sound doctrine, and I get to write down. He's the only apostle that wrote down all the doctrine for us. All the doctrine that we are to follow and how we are saved for the last 2,000 years was solely written down by one guy, Paul. Boy, What a responsibility. What a great opportunity. As the prisoner of the Lord, it says, as the prisoner of the Lord, as this great commission that I've been given here, I beseech you that ye walk worthy of the vocation wherewith ye are called. Again, all things are lawful. He's not going to command you, you got to do this. He says, walk worthy. So Ephesians 4:1, walk worthy of the vocation. The way I think about it is, you think of, let's say, right now you got King Charles, King of England. Then you've got, let's say, the common guy. Let's say you got Buckingham Palace, and there's King Charles, and he's in Buckingham Palace. Then you got some guy down the road from there who lives on the streets. He's homeless, and he's a drunk. You've never met either one of them in person. You've never met King Charles, and you've never met the drunk there. Let's say that's for some reason he's, you know, the drunk's close to Buckingham Palace. For some reason, you both of them are there at once, and you meet them. Your expectation of how King Charles would behave toward you would be a whole lot different than your expectation of how the drunk would behave toward you. You know what that's about. You meet poor people, rich people, intelligent people, not so intelligent people. People who are following their emotions and their feelings, like getting drunk or on drugs, and people who are very calm, not so emotional, very level-headed, rational-type thinking people. You know what that's all about. You know, you have, when you, somebody you know, you have expectation levels of how they'll perform, what they'll say, what they'll do in a situation. And usually you change how you react with them. I mean, you treat a baby and a toddler and an 8-year-old and a 15-year-old and a 20-year-old and a 50-year-old and an 80-year-old. You treat all of them different just based upon their age and their maturity level. And then each of them are different maturity and rich and poor and emotional and all that, level-headed. They have differences from that person compared to the other people their age. When you think of how King Charles, so let's say the drunk down the road, you meet the drunk and you meet King Charles. You would not be surprised to hear the drunk cursing like a sailor, you know, cursing up a storm and talking about really base things of the world. Whereas King Charles, you'd be completely surprised if he punched you, if he started cursing, giving profanities at you, if he decided to take his shirt off and go topless. In other words, there are things, behavior of King Charles, there's certain behaviors that fit his position versus the drunk down the road who doesn't have that position. Well, what's your position? Philippians 3. Verse 20, Philippians 3:20 says, our conversation is in heaven. Conversation there is an old English word, meaning your lifestyle. People use citizenship. Modern translations, our citizenship is in heaven. This goes beyond that. Because that drunk down the road from Buckingham Palace, he's a citizen of England. King Charles is also a citizen of England. But King Charles acts a lot better than the drunk because of his position. So, citizenship in heaven. Paul would act a lot better in heaven than, say, somebody who was an unbeliever and atheist and did all these bad stuff and then had a deathbed repentance, believed the gospel in the end. They're both citizens of heaven. But Paul is probably at a throne position. He's probably at a high, very high ranking position in heavenly places. Whereas the deathbed repentance guy is in every name that is named. They're both citizens in heaven. But they have different positions. So just like I would expect King Charles to act a whole lot better than the drunk down the road from him, I'm also going to expect Paul to act a whole lot better in heaven than someone who just had deathbed repentance and was saved at the end, who had no knowledge of mystery doctrine. He just believed, you know, thief on the cross type thing. Believe the gospel, I'm saved, and then I die shortly thereafter. That's why it's important to understand our conversation, not citizenship. We're all citizens if you've trusted in Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection as atonement for your sin. We're citizens of heaven. Our conversation, not our citizenship, but conversation has to do with your lifestyle is in heaven. And that's where you have a difference from King Charles versus the drunk down the road from King Charles. The lifestyle of King Charles is a lot different from the drunk. So that's why it says our conversation is in heaven. So then, Ephesians 4:1, walk worthy of the vocation wherewith ye are called. Well, what's the vocation? It is bringing God glory by sharing God's love through me for all eternity as a result of the sound doctrine I got in the inner man. Romans 12:3 says, for I say through the grace given unto me to every man that is among you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think soberly, according as God hath dealt to every man the measure of faith. Romans 12:3 says, live according to faith within you. Paul has a greater measure of faith than I do. I have greater measure of faith than the guy who has the deathbed repentance. Faith cometh by hearing, hearing by the word. I've got more sound doctrine in me than a deathbed repentance guy. Paul has more sound doctrine in him than I do. So I am to live according to that sound doctrine within me. So when he says, walk worthy of the vocation wherewith ye are called, it is walk according to your conversation in heaven. Your lifestyle is in heaven. So just like King Charles wouldn't go around acting like a drunk and cursing out people, it's not in public. I certainly, since my conversation is in heaven, I shouldn't be living in sin. For me to walk worthy of the vocation wherewith I am called, I walk according to the position in heavenly places that I would have, according to the measure of faith that's built up within me, according to the sound doctrine that I have in the inner man, according to how I've used the mind of Christ and had God's love come through me. So walking worthy of vocation wherewith you are called is walking according to that position that you would have, basically walking according to the faith within you. So the guy has a deathbed repentance, who cursed like a sailor before he believed the gospel, he's probably still going to curse. Maybe he's got two more days to live. He's probably still going to do that for 2 days. And that's fine, because he doesn't have the measure of faith built up within him. But me, I should never do that. I should never curse because of Christ in me. I know cursing is done for comedic effect and all kinds of things, but really, it's a sign of unintelligence. I mean, you could curse and you could communicate what you're saying by just using curse words, but it's more effective if you use words that fit, that define it. You're a more effective communicator if you use words that fit the situation better. If I'm just mad at somebody and I just use the F word, you know, the F bomb, and I drop that, they could tell I'm angry. But why am I angry? Well, if I communicate it without cursing, and they could see by the tone of my voice that I'm angry, but yet I explain it. Well, now you've got a lot more information. You've got information that I'm angry, and you know why I'm angry. It's not just that I'm angry. You're a more effective communicator. Anyway, I don't know why I got off on that, but walking worthy of the vocation wherewith you are called is simply walking according to the faith that's within you. Ephesians 2:8-9, for by grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. Verse 10, a lot of times we stop there. Verse 10, we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto good works, which God hath before ordained that we should walk in them. Ephesians 2:10 does not tell you to do the good works. It says walk in good works. How you do that is you walk in the Spirit. How do you walk in the Spirit is you go by the sound doctrine in the inner man. So when Ephesians 4:1 says you walk worthy of the vocation wherewith ye are called, it means you're going to act like your lifestyle is in heaven. When I'm in a throne, a principality, power, might, or dominion in heavenly places, I'm not going to curse. So guess what? I shouldn't curse now. I'm going to live by the sound doctrine in the inner man. So guess what I should do now? Live by the sound doctrine in the inner man. So walking worthy of the vocation wherewith you are called is telling you to live according to the faith in you. Walk in the good works. The way you walk in the good works, remember, Christ liveth in you. It's just, you're just a keg in the process, basically. Christ is doing the work in you. And so you just go along with it. You know, it's sort of like being on a treadmill. When I'm on a treadmill, I'm just going along. The treadmill is going at that level, and I keep walking. And so I'm walking. Not saying treadmill may be a bad example, because a lot of things we think of legalism. But when I'm saying that in grace, it's just that we're going according to the process. You know, the treadmill is set at 3 miles an hour. So I'm going to walk. I'm not going to walk at 4. I'm not going to walk at 2. I'm going to walk at 3. Walking worthy of the vocation wherewith you called is walking according to the measure of faith within you. So if I've got a lot of sound doctrine in the inner man, I'm going to have great faith that I walk in, that I live by. And it's really Christ living in me, yet not I but Christ. I live by the faith of the Son of God. I present my body a living sacrifice. Christ is living in me. That's why it's walk worthy of the vocation wherewith you are called. It's basically, I'm going to get the sound doctrine in the inner man. I'm going to use the mind of Christ. That's how you walk worthy of the vocation wherewith you are called. And you'll only walk according to the measure of faith within you. Now, when you get down to verses 2 and 3, you notice Ephesians 4, 2 and 3 now. He says it's basically the attitude of what you will do. You know, Paul says over in 1 Corinthians, I think it's chapter 8. 1 Corinthians 8 and verse 1. Let's put that up here. He says in 1 Corinthians 8 and verse 1, knowledge puffeth up, but charity edifieth. Ephesians 1 through 3, we've gone through that already, has a lot of great sound doctrine, and that's purpose. But now in Ephesians 4, we're going to apply that doctrine. If I get Ephesians 1 through 3 memorized and I understand all that doctrine, it does no good if I don't have the love of Christ coming through me. Just having the knowledge of it doesn't do any good. Because remember John 13:35, by this shall all men know that ye are my disciples if ye have love one for another. In heavenly places, I'm going to bring God glory by God's love coming through me as I apply the doctrine. So it's not enough just to know the doctrine, quote the doctrine. Because if it's just the doctrine, knowledge puffeth up. But it's charity that edifieth, that builds, edify meaning it builds it up. Ephesians 2 ended in verse 21, Ephesians 2:21, in whom? In Christ. All the building fitly framed together groweth unto a holy temple in the Lord, in whom you also are builded together for a habitation of God through the Spirit. So we get the sound doctrine in the inner man, but then we apply it and God's love comes through us, and now we're growing as that holy temple in the Lord. It's edifying, or it's growing, it's being built up. And so when you got Ephesians 4, verse 1, walk worthy of the vocation wherewith you are called, keep in mind, not only are you going to live by the faith within you, living by the sound doctrine, but you should also have the right attitude behind it. One danger, and you see this a lot with theologians, is they get all puffed up in their knowledge. What we want to do is if we forget the sound doctrine and we're applying it, then we use the love of Christ. Now you got charity coming through you. Charity is a special word that describes God's unconditional love. You know, a man's love for his wife or his wife's love for the husband is not charity. It's not unconditional, unless, of course, Christ's love coming through them. But apart from Christ, it's maybe the highest love you've got and that man knows, but it's still conditional. God's love is purely unconditional. You know, 1 Corinthians 13, verses 4 through 8 tells you God's love. Charity suffereth long and is kind. Charity envieth not. Charity vaunteth not itself, is not puffed up. Doth not behave itself unseemly, seeketh not her own, is not easily provoked, thinketh no evil. Rejoiceth not in iniquity, but rejoiceth in truth. Beareth all things, believeth all things, hopeth all things, endureth all things. Charity never faileth. That's the charity, God's love, the unconditional love. And so, what he's trying to tell you, now that you've got the doctrine of Ephesians 1 through 3, you walk worthy of the vocation wherewith you're called, so you walk according to the measure of faith within you, but you got to remember, charity is what's going to edify. You've got to have God's love come through you. So that's why he says there in Ephesians 4, 2, that not only are you going to walk with faith, but Ephesians 4, 2, with all lowliness and meekness. So he starts, we might as well put it up here, lowliness and meekness. Lowliness, it's yet not I but Christ. Ye are dead and your life is hid with Christ in God. Lowliness, I'm dead. You can't get any lower than that. I'm dead, so that's your lowliness. Meekness is basically, it is sharing God's love, sharing sound doctrine, sharing God's love, but doing it in an unemotional type of way. It is, not that you can't be, it's probably the wrong way of saying, not that you can't be emotional. I mean, Christ, he overthrew the tables of the money changers. He did things with emotion. But it's that you're keeping an even keel of the situation. You're not letting your emotions control you. Emotions, especially being pride, because knowledge puffeth up. And so charity is not, it's going to have all those characteristics of verses 4 through 8. So basically it is, I guess you could say meekness would be love with humbleness. Maybe that's the way to do it. And again, that doesn't mean you can't be angry and enforcing that. I mean, I get pretty angry at the false doctrine that's out there, and that's fine. But you don't want to be lording over them. You don't just shotting off a bunch of verses to show you know better than they do and how stupid they are because they got the false doctrine. No, you just calmly go through it. And you can be angry, especially if they're not listening. It may cause you to raise your voice to try to get their attention. But it's the love of God coming through you, but with humbleness. It's not me puffing myself up trying to show I'm better than anybody else, that I have more knowledge, I quote scripture better than anybody else, but it's just showing, it's calmly going through it without letting my pride and the emotions get involved. Although, you know, again, I can be angry, but that's fine if that's what's called for in that situation. It is just a humbleness of, yeah, not I, but Christ. Christ liveth in me. I just have the unique opportunity. You notice the humbleness in Ephesians 4:1 that Paul says he is the prisoner of the Lord. He's not puffing himself up there. He says, I beseech you, you walk worthy of the vocation wherewith ye are called. What are you called to? Well, you're bought with a price. Bought with the great price of Jesus' shed blood. So he's saying lowliness and meekness. So lowliness is, I'm dead, my life is hid with Christ in God. Meekness is God's love coming through you with the humbleness of it. Not lording over people, not being prideful in what you know. You know, I know how to rightly divide the word of truth. I got more sound doctrine in my pinky than that person has in their whole body. So that'd be pride. You don't want to do that. You're just saying, well, you know, all of us, we're dead in trespasses and sins. And any good thing in me is Christ living in me. It's nothing to do with me. Granted, I may have taken the time to read God's word and let the doctrine get through me that way, but it's really God's provided the word. The Holy Ghost taught it to me, and it's the mind of Christ I'm using to apply it. It's really all three members of the Godhead working through me here. It's not anything about me. So you have love with humbleness. And then it says, with long-suffering. Long-suffering. A lot of times your modern translations change that to patience. Long-suffering goes beyond patience. Patience is when I'm sitting here waiting for my wife to get dressed and to get her hair set, get all ready to go wherever we're going. And so, I mean, I'm not suffering. I'm not in pain. I just sit in there and I say, okay, well, I'll read my Bible, or I'll watch TV, or I'll do whatever, or I just sit there patiently waiting, you know. That's patience. Long suffering is when you're actually suffering. You know, you're in pain, and you do it a long time, really. That's a great characteristic of God. Habakkuk, book of Habakkuk, one of my favorite verses. Habakkuk 1:13. Habakkuk 1:13 is a great description of the long-suffering of God. Habakkuk 1:13 says, "Thou art of purer eyes than to behold evil, and canst not look on iniquity." So God can't look on iniquity. He can't behold evil. He's holy. He's purer than that. You know, it's like somebody that has OCD. If I was to have a bunch of dirt on this screen, on this board, you know, OCD person, well, you got to clean that up. You got to erase it. I remember I was working one time, and the boss, brilliant person, she was very good in finances, I gave her my whatever she asked for. She had like five or six revisions on it that all had to do with formatting. And in my eyes, I'm thinking, well, I must have really done a good job with the paper, because all she's doing, or the report I gave her, because all she's doing is making sure this is centered and this is aligned and this is bolded or this is underlined and all this stuff. So I figure, well, the details must be good. So I go through all these revisions, like five or six revisions, and I get all the detail, the formatting perfect. And then what she does is then she starts saying, okay, well, what about this number? What does this number mean? What is this? It's like for her, she was so OCD that she couldn't really analyze the data until it was all perfectly exactly how she wanted it, because she couldn't really think beyond the, oh, this over here is in a line. You notice that number? It's slightly to the right. And, you know, I've noticed that in Excel, the number formatting, if you have the parentheses for the negative numbers versus a minus in front, the alignment is slightly off. I never knew that till she pointed that out to me, you know, because she was so OCD about it that she had the obsessive compulsive disorder. She couldn't even look at the numbers until they're all lined up. Well, you can think of God, of course, God, you know, is holy, and he's all-knowing and all-powerful, so it's not like he's limited by, like he's OCD. But the point I'm making is, he can't look on iniquity. So just like that woman, it hurt her to try to look at the numbers if it's not aligned. It hurts God to look at sin, because he's holy, he's perfect, he's pure. So Habakkuk 1:13, "Thou art of purer eyes than to behold iniquity, and canst not look, purer eyes than to behold evil, and canst not look on iniquity." So what does that mean? That means he suffers, because this world is full of iniquity. But you look over in 1 Peter, I think it's 1 Peter. 1 Peter. No, it's probably not 1 Peter. It's probably 2 Peter. 2 Peter 3. 2 Peter 3, 9. "The Lord is not slack concerning his promises, some men count slackness, but is long-suffering to usward, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance." 2 Peter 3, 9. God is long-suffering. And the reason he is suffering long is because he says, well, maybe more people will be saved. Maybe more will come into the knowledge of the truth. Yes, I'm of pure eyes and I can't look on iniquity. and it hurts me. It's I suffer when I look on iniquity and sin. But I'm going to suffer, and I'm going to do it a long time. Because I want people to be saved, and people can still be saved. So, patience, waiting for my wife to get ready to go somewhere. Long-suffering with her is she's in the hospital with COVID. I'm in the hospital with COVID too. But it's not just I'm not just patiently waiting for her to get out, but I'm suffering and saying, my wife, who's a part of me, we two have become one. And the one who's a part of me is suffering, and her life is at stake. So then I'm suffering with her. It's not just so that's the difference between patience and long suffering. Patience is waiting for her to get ready, so I'm just waiting. But long suffering is I'm waiting, but I'm suffering while I'm waiting. You know. So that's the difference. So what are we told here in Ephesians 4:2? With all lowliness and meekness, with long suffering. Why are we long suffering? Well, because Christ is living in us. If Christ is living in us, we're walking in the Spirit, then we also can't look on iniquity. We suffer at it, for it. We look at the decisions. I mean, there are a lot of things that have happened in the United States, in the world, really, since COVID. A lot of decisions that have ramped up the wicked and evil in the world. A lot of people, even people who go to church, don't even notice it. They think the world's better now than it was 3 years ago. Spiritually speaking, it's a whole lot worse. And you hear of new decisions, new laws, new things that are done. And you hear these stories and all like drag queen story hour. And you suffer just hearing that stuff. Because Christ in you sees the wicked and the evil agenda behind it. So someone else looks at it and they say, oh, that's great. You know, they're tolerant. We're going to be loving to everybody. But you look at it and say, wow, they're just spreading evil and they're hurting our kids with this drag queen story hour. And so now they'll be less likely to hear the gospel and believe it and be saved and come into the knowledge of the truth. And so that's Christ in you saying that. And so that's why it says long-suffering, because God can't look on iniquity. And God is long-suffering, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. And so as Christ lives in you and you're in a world that doesn't follow Christ, then you are suffering along with, or Christ in you is suffering. That's why it says with all lowliness and meekness, with long suffering. And then, verse 2, forbearing one another in love. And that's part of the suffering. You read like you read Romans 14, the weak brother versus the strong brother. You read, 1 Corinthians 8? Same type of thing. Yeah. So you read like Romans 14 and 1 Corinthians 8. You know, you've got sound doctrine in the inner man, but someone else doesn't. They're a saved person, and you come across this all the time. Where you and this other person, you've both gone to heaven. You both trusted in Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection as atonement for your sin. But you understand that Paul is our apostle. You understand that the doctrine for today is in Romans through Philemon. And this other person doesn't understand that. And they think we should be following red letter Jesus, Matthew through John. So you shouldn't just get angry with them and just say, well, Paul is our apostle. We should just read Romans through Philemon. Forget about Matthew through John. Well, that's Jesus' words to us. No, it's not to you. Jesus' words to us is in Paul. Don't read Matthew. Don't tonight, just go home and read Romans. Don't read Matthew through John. Read Romans. And keep reading it until you understand it. See, what I'm doing there, it's not... Sure, I gave him good information. There was no charity in it. No lowliness or meekness. I'm not suffering long with them. And I'm not forbearing one another in love. Instead, I got to be gentle, you know, and take the time with them and explain these things. I said, well, you know, Jesus said in John 6:63, the words that I speak unto you, they are spirit and they are life. The way that we have God live through us is by the words that Jesus has given unto us. Now, Jesus, since he is the Word, He commanded in Leviticus 1 through 10. He gave sacrifices. Why aren't you doing those? Well, because you understand that while that is Jesus' words, and it's the Bible, and it's true, and we should be reading that stuff, it's not commandment specifically given to you. It was for Israel and in their time period. So you understand that. So you understand that you're not going to try to obey every single word in your Bible. You're going to try to obey and follow the commandments that are specifically given to you, and that's a good thing. So, similarly speaking then, since Jesus said the words that I speak unto you, they are spirit and they are life, I got to find out what the words are. Paul says in 1 Corinthians 14:37, the commandments I give you, they are commandments of the Lord. And you can go over things, you know, like the mystery, revelation of the mystery, Romans 16:25 through 26, and go over, you know, Ephesians 3, which we just went over in the last few lessons. And you just calmly go through the verses, and as they have questions, you give them those answers. I could tell you, difference for me, growing up in the church I grew up in, I believed that if you sinned, you lost your salvation, you got to ask for forgiveness, and then you're okay until you sin again, then you got to ask for forgiveness, so you could lose your salvation. So in sixth grade, it was a Baptist-run school that I was in. Most of the people believed in eternal security. I did not. So in sixth grade, I had a debate, and I gave them doctrine to show you could lose your salvation. And then the other side, you know, gave doctrine says you could not lose your salvation. I read this verse. I'll just give this example. I read Revelation 2:5 says, remember therefore from whence thou art fallen, and repent, and do the first works, or else I will come unto thee quickly, and will remove thy candlestick out of this place, except thou repent. So I said, okay, Revelation 2:5 shows, where am I here? I'm here. Okay. Okay, Revelation 2:5 shows conditional salvation. Okay. Now the teacher at the school I was in, her response to this was, well, we don't really know what that means. She had the right doctrine, eternal security, but she didn't have right division. Okay. So she says, we don't really know what that means. Well, that didn't do me any good. So I continued to believe that I could lose my salvation. Then, fast forward, that was sixth grade. So then fast forward to, I'm about 18 years old, and then some guy who knows right division shares eternal security, showing the verses. And again, Revelation 2:5, how do you explain that one, right? Well, he explained right division to me. And he didn't act like I was an idiot or a moron. Or, you know, I thought you're studying your Bible. Why don't you even know who your apostle is? Don't you even know what part of the scripture was written to you? No, he didn't do that. He says, well, let's go back to the verses. Revelation 2. It's to the seven churches. Seven churches in Asia. That's not you. Revelation 7, you see, there are 144,000 sealed, 12,000 of each tribe of Israel. That's not you. You're not a tribe of Israel. But Ephesians 2 says, by grace you are saved through faith. Romans 5 says, you're now justified by his blood. You've now received the atonement. So you just go over the verses in love, just having patience, or long-suffering, because you're seeing resistance, because your flesh is going to resist. So you're long-suffering, and you forbear one another in love. And so he did that, and so this was in sixth grade, and I still continued to believe in conditional salvation. But then when I get to be 18, now I believe in eternal security. And the reason is because someone forbore me in love and was long-suffering and went over sound doctrine with me and didn't call me an idiot or a moron and say, well, why don't you just read Paul's epistles? Don't you know he's our apostle? He never said that. And he went over and said, well, who is that talking to? You know, I bring up Hebrews. Who's that talking to? That's talking to the Hebrews. Oh, okay, yeah, I guess Hebrews is talking to the Hebrews. Are you a Hebrew? No. Okay, well then, you know, and he's just calmly going through this stuff. And over a period of a few messages, you know, one-on-one, well, it was me and my uncle and him, and my grandmother, he's calmly going over my questions, calmly going over the verses, and eventually I believe it. See, what he did was he forbore one another in love. So it's not enough that you have knowledge, because knowledge puffeth up. But you also got to have charity. Charity edifies. So forbearing one another in love. And then verse 3, Ephesians 4, 3, endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. So we're going to, the endeavor is we've got the unity of the Spirit, meaning we're going to follow sound doctrine. We're going to operate by the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus. And in the bond of peace is a bond is something that brings you together. Romans 5, 1 says, therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. So all the body of Christ has peace with God. And that's a common bond that we have. So all believers have bond of peace because we have that peace with God. Los Angeles Dodgers, they all wear the Dodger uniform. They have a common bond that they are Dodgers. For us, since we all have believed the gospel, the body of Christ, we have peace with God. So we all have a common bond. As a Dodger, you shouldn't be trying to do things that would go against your own team. You know, oh, I want to hit the home run. Well, it's better that you bunt the ball and get this guy home from third, and then we can win the game. Yeah, but it looks better on me if I hit a home run. So you try to hit the home run and you strike out. So now you lost the game. So you looked out for yourself, and now you lost the game. But if you worked for the team, you bunted the ball, maybe you'd have won the game. So there's a unity because we're all on the same team. So it's the same thing here. We all have peace with God because we've all believers. We're all saved. And so when we do this lowliness and meekness with long-suffering, forbearing one another in love, what we're doing there is we're endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit and the bond of peace. We're all on the same team. We're all in the body of Christ. We're all going to have positions in heavenly places. Some of us have higher positions than the others. But if you're in a higher position, don't lord it over the people who are lower than you. But instead, you want to edify them, build them up. Next time, we're out of time. Now, next time, we'll see verses 4 through 6. One body, one spirit, one hope of your calling, all that stuff. It's all one in Christ. So let's stop there. Let's close in a word of prayer. Dear Lord, we thank you for the glory plan. Help us, Lord, to not get puffed up in the knowledge that we have, but to get that sound doctrine and then apply it and grow in the love of Christ so that others may be saved and come into the knowledge of the truth, and we'll bring you greater glory in the church by Christ Jesus throughout all ages, world without end. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, next time we'll start in Ephesians 4:3 and then go forward from there. Thanks for watching.